not a dream. I was in slavery. About 1850 was the time. Sorrow was the only sign. Nothing around to ease my mind. Out of the night appeared a woman leading a distant pilgrim back. First night she cried, pointing out her hand. They grew my heart for this young woman, saying, come on up. I got a lifeline. Come on up to this train of mine. Come on up. I got a lifeline. Come on up to this train of mine. And her name was Harriet Tubman. And she threw
only 17 years old when she married the abolitionist John Brown. Years ago, Peggy Ayers, an Adirondack songwriter, came across a letter Mary received from her husband shortly before he was to be hanged for the attack on Harper's Ferry. This is the songwriter's attempt to walk in Mary's shoes as she heard the news. November 1st, 1859. Dear John, affectionate husband of mine. Mr. Higginson, the newsman came today. I regretfully heard what he had to say. He told me of the trial your righteousness denied. We formed an escort, I will be there by your side. Before they hang you, we will have time to share our plans to bring you home and one final prayer. We may not see the slaves go free. Neither did Moses reach the promised land. Still none can be more blessed than we, who are an instrument in God's hand. Here in North Elba, we women carry on. All I'm making ready so I may leave at dawn. Oliver's widow has a fever running wild. I doubt the future of her unborn child. Sarah and Ellen, it seems a midland well. They did not shrink from the news I had to tell. I know that they will miss your presence in their lives. Your love and faithfulness in them are burning bright. We may not see the slaves go free. Neither did Moses reach the promised land.
It was published 2 weeks after the Emancipation Proclamation went into effect. It gives much credit to John Brown for ending slavery. John Brown died on a scaffold for the slave. Dark was the hour when we dug his hallowed grave. Now God avenges the life that we gave.
Shall be gone.
all men will sing in the better ages dawn. Freedom reigns today. Because drunkenness was linked to domestic abuse. And some women wanted the vote so they could vote in prohibition. The symbol of the temperance movement was a white banner, and women wore white ribbon bows to signal their affiliation. So one example of many songs that referred to the white ribbon was the White Ribbon Star-Spangled Banner.
Mm-hmm. And I might mention that my great-grandmother was involved in the temperance movement here in Boston.
The Women's Christian Temperance Union.
Yes, the Women's Christians Temperance Union, WTC. Fling, ready? Fling it out to the breeze. Let it tell to the world that the faith which has raised it will never surrender. Let it tell that the love which our banner unfurled is the guard of the home and the nation's defender. Let it gleam as a star for the shipwrecked afar, like a beacon that warns of the treacherous bar. Let the banner of freedom and purity wave, like the singing of home, midst the perils we brave. Let it fly at the front, it is washed in our tears, and the smoke of the battle increases its whiteness. Though our hearts may be pierced by the enemy's spears, let the flow from our wounds shall just add to its brightness. And this ensign of light, it shall float o'er the fight, till our wrongs are avenged by the triumph of right, and in radiant victory at last it shall wave o'er the ramparts we've stormed, o'er King
women's suffrage songs. I should mention, by the way, that we got a lot of these songs from a record called Songs of the Women's Suffrage Movement that I actually got it on a Folkways record, but it's now available on CD. So this first women's suffrage song, note, explicitly states that women are going to the polls to put down the liquor traffic. The men should see the women going to the polls to put down the liquor traffic,
need it next their souls.
If we're angels as they tell us, can we well suppose that all the men would frown on us when
going to the polls? We love our boys, our household joys, we love our girls as well. The laurel love is from above, against that we ne'er rebel.
Discharge have Christian women from the war with sin at the polls with Gog and Magog must the fight begin. Since we Bible marching orders, let it fright our souls. Who all the men can frown on us but going to the polls.
We love our boys, our household joys, we love our girls as well. The laurel love is from a focus that we dare rebel.
Smythe, and she was a courageous writer, not a musician, so I stuck it to a melody. Shout, shout, shout with your song, cry with the wind, for the dawn is breaking. March, march, swing you along, wide blows our banner, and hope is waking, love with its story, glad with their glory, dreams not a story. Loud, loud, loudly they call, thunder of freedom, our voice shall be heard. Long, long, covered in dread by the light of heaven. Strong, strong, stand we at last, fearless and faith with the sight you give, and strength in its beauty, life with its duty. Hear the voice, oh hear and obey. These beckon us on, open your eyes to the blaze of day. Comrades, you who have dared first in the battle and strive in sorrow, scorn, scorn, burned and cared, raising your eyes to a wider morrow, ways that are weary, days that are dreary, toil and pain by faith you have borne.
To a familiar tune. I have a neighbor, one of those not very hard to find, who knows it all without debate and never change their mind. I asked him, what of woman's rights? He said, in tones severe,
my mind on that is all made up. Keep woman in her sphere.
I saw a man in tattered garb forth from the grog shop come. He squandered all his cash on drink and starved his wife at home. I asked him, should not woman vote? He answered with a sneer,
I taught my wife her place in life. Keep woman in her sphere.
I met an honest, thoughtful man not many days ago, who pondered all deep human law, the honest truth to know. I asked him, what of woman's cause? The answer came sincere.
Her rights are just the same as mine. Let woman choose her sphere.
Right on, dude.
Thank you, Mr. Barrett.
Bring the good old bugle, boys. We'll sing another song. Sing it with a spirit that shall start the walls along. Sing it as we are, sing it cheerily and strong, giving the ballad to the mothers. Hoorah, hoorah, we bring the jubilee. Hoorah, hoorah, the homes they shall be free. So we'll sing the chorus from the mountains to the sea, giving the ballad to the mothers. Bring the dear old banner, boys, and fling it to the wind. Mother, wife, and daughter, let it shelter and defend. Equal rights, our motto is, we're loyal to the end. Giving the ballot to the mothers. Hoorah, 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 we bring the jubilee. Hoorah, hoorah, the homes they shall be free. So we'll sing the chorus from the mountains.
That looks like it's off to a good start, since he's giving his wife, granting her permission to have her own mind. I'll sing a song called "Let Us Speak, Let Us All Speak Our Minds," and it's kind of a tongue-in-cheek a little bit. Men tell us 'tis fit that wives should submit to their husbands submissively weakly. Though whatever they say, their wife should obey, unquestioning, stupidly, meekly. But whatever I'll wear for, their own dictum take, without ever a question or why for it. But I don't and I can't and I won't and I shan't. No, I will speak my mind if I die for it. Well, we know it's all fudge to say man's the best judge of what should be and shouldn't and so on. That man should bow nor attempt to say how. I made a mistake, is that women should bow nor attempt to say how. She considers that life should go on. But I never yet gave up myself as a slave, however my husband might try for it. For I can't and I won't and I shan't and I won't, and I will speak my mind if I die for it. So all ladies, I hope, who with husbands do cope, with the rights of the sex will not trifle. We can, if we choose, our tongue but to use, can all opposition soon stifle. Let man, if he will, bid us be still, and silence upon. for we won't and we can't and we don't and we shan't. Let us all speak our mind if we die for it.
So you will join in on the chorus. Suffrage song, and it's about this. It starts in 1840 at the World Anti-Slavery Convention in London, England, where Lucretia Mott, the great orator from Massachusetts, she traveled all across the Atlantic to speak on women's suffrage, the rights. Well, actually, on abolition at the time. And what happened was she was denied the right to speak. And so, in the song, this is the seed of this 72-year struggle, which began in 1848 at the first Women's Rights Convention, which Lucretia and her new friend, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, organized. And so the song actually begins with a woman being silenced. And so here is the story of the beginning of a 72-year struggle that began with that began way back then and ended in 1920 with the passage of the 19th Amendment.
And Sean, who wrote the song?
And I wrote the song.
All right.
Lucretia Mott sailed the sea to speak out against slavery. But a rule of silence shut her down. Your voice cannot be allowed, said the all-male convention crowd. This is a public place, and a woman can't utter a sound. Hypocrisy, so absurd as they wrap themselves in freedom's words, holding the chains of male domination. Elizabeth Stanton at her side, Lucretia vowed to turn the tide, and together they planted the seeds of a revolution. In chilly winds and the darkest nights, they held on like geese in flight for their sister's sake, preparing to fight. In a little town near Seneca Falls, in rural upstate New York, Elizabeth and Lucretia called up a meeting
Five women in a circle having tea, yearning for equality. A women's rights convention, they decided they would be meeting. 1848, in the heat of July, women and girls came from far and wide, daring to confront their state of subjugation. Elizabeth Stanton had taken the floor for the right to vote. She did implore, and the words she spoke would echo for generations. And through chilly winds and the darkest nights, they held on like peace and fight for their sister's sake, getting ready to fight. Brave leaders emerged to advance the cause. Truth gave Alice Paul, hungering in prison to amend the Constitution. After 72 years of struggle and pain, with the 19th Amendment women overcame. In August 1920 we marched in jubilation. Through chilly winds and the darkest nights, we held on like yeast in flight for our sister's sake. We were ready to fight. Now all these years later, we've made many gains, but the patriarchy still remains in a constant state of war with all creation. Rising from the seeds of former the sowed, millions of women are coming to know that the fate of Mother Earth depends on our mobilization. Through chilly winds and the darkest we'll hold on like he said, fight for all our sakes. We gotta fight. Through chilly winds and the darkest nights, we'll hold on like he said, fight for Mother Earth. We gotta fight. We gotta fight. We gotta fight.
Travel all the way up to Seneca Falls to perform it. She was gracious enough to invite me to come along, and we met these characters who were the real deal. I mean, you couldn't tell that they weren't these women because they were so dressed up and so exactly perfect. And you know how it is when you meet a real an actor? You do not actually, they do not break.
Right.
They are that person for the day. So
we got to perform that.
Was that
Elizabeth's house, mm-hmm. Elizabeth Cady Stanton's home, which is a national landmark today. So it was really an honor to be at it.
Just at the march, this past one?
It was in this past July.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it was really an honor to be at her house during the summer.
Sadly, the national parks are suffering right now.
Yeah.
So we have to add that to our campaign, is how to raise money for the national parks, because they are our heritage.
We had actually been asked to do a performance at the FDR Library, which is near where I live,
Hyde Park.
In Hyde Park, and then they had to rescind because they had no money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Canceled. Rescheduled. Canceled.
Well, canceled. So far it's canceled.
Yeah. So the next song that we're going to do is close to our closing. We're getting ready to hear Colleen's song and answer any questions you might have or a song that you might want to add to it. I think we have time, don't we?
Yes, we do. Yeah.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Or I can just keep talking. They did all the talking. That's my turn. I'm just kidding. Okay.
Well, we're going to do a song by a PMN member,
yes.
Ruth Pelham.
Oh,
the famous. Probably know
it. Great New York. Another great New Yorker, right?
That's right. Albany.
Brooklyn.
Right. Now she's
in
Albany.
Well, she was born
from Brooklyn, yeah.
She
can't take
from
the Brooklyn.
She's from my neighborhood.
You can't take the Brooklyn out.
Yeah, that's right. That's exactly what
you
she
take the girl out of the Brooklyn, but you can't take Brooklyn out of
God.
It.
You
ready?
No,
no,
here we go.
I am a woman here on planet Earth. I have the breath of life in me, a gift given. No one, nobody, no powers that be can ever, ever, ever take this gift.
Nobody live there. if we have more time, we throw them in, but you get the idea. So, shall we have Colleen do her song? And then
just yes. Make an announcement. We're going to be at the People's Voice Cafe, and I have flyers right here, on March 10th to celebrate International Women's Month.
Wonderful.
And then the very next, in case there's anybody here who has a connection to anyone in New Jersey, we're going to do our first show in New Jersey, my current home state, in Teaneck, New Jersey, for New Jersey National Organization of Women are inviting us to perform. So we'll have back-to-back shows in March. And if you want to check our website, it's just Rumors of Peace. You just go on the Women's Suffrage link on the top of the page, and we have some videos, bios, and our calendar there. So appreciate so much you being here. It really is a lot.
I would like to mention that one of the songs we haven't done is one about Wyoming. And Wyoming was the first state, way ahead of everybody else, to grant women suffrage. It was, of course, a practical thing. They had very few people in Wyoming, and a lot of women were ranchers, and independent ranchers. As a matter of fact, I know that some women had no men around at all.
Nice.
So it's a beautiful song, and I will share it with you guys another time. Last night we had the honor of hearing Miss Colleen Cateau, so I will invite her up to introduce her song, her suffrage song.
Right.
All right, girl.
Would you mind if I use your guitar?
Oh, you know, I was going to offer it.
Oh, great.
You
thank
have
you. I wasn't going to, yeah.
You have exquisite permission.
Oh, thank you.
And there's a capo right there.
Oh,
it's the best place to stand because the microphone is right there.
All right, great.
This side.
Yeah, I thought we were just going to do like a little in the round thing, you know, so.
Thank you for
I haven't done this song in a while, but thank you for letting me do it.
Do you need this or not?
No, I don't need it for this one. Thank you. This is a great guitar. So I live in Central New York, and you mentioned Gage, Elizabeth, Matilda Jocelyn Gage.
Yes.
And she, anybody not familiar with who she was?
Yeah.
Matilda Jocelyn Gage was, she wrote a treatise called Woman, Church, and State. She was really a prescient radical. She was the mother-in-law of L. Frank Baum, who wrote The Wizard of Oz. And really, there's a major attribution of, you know, that a little-known fact is like she encouraged her son-in-law to write his fantasies down, to write his stories down.
And to be a pacifist.
Yes, and she
to
was a really
put women first.
She was really a mentor to him. And the thing about Gage is that, I mean, it's no surprise that the suffrage movement started in Central New York, largely. Maybe there were rumblings in other movements, but because of the Native American influence there, and the Haudenosaunee, and so Gage really, Matilda Jocelyn Gage really learned a lot from her Native women friends, and saw that how much equality they had, and how little the Victorian women had at the time. So there's a wonderful historian, I'm not going to go over, but her name is Sally Roche Wagner, and she used to do these incredible, she used to channel Gage. She actually has made it her life work to resurrect the incredible legacy of this woman. Her name is Sally Roche Wagner, and she actually bought the Gage home in Fayetteville, New York, and it is a wonderful place for, it's a foundation and a museum, and there's lots of and she continues her work. And so mainly, one of the things that I read her essay. I'd love to share it with you. She read it at the New York State Fair, not this last summer, but the summer before. And Sally and I worked together, and I like to take kind of essays and put them into music. So I hope I can remember all the words. But this is called Dangerous Women, because if you look at some of the posters at the time when women were dangerous, right, the idea of danger. And look up the etymology of danger, too. It's very interesting. It's a little bit kind of different than our notion of danger. But women were too dangerous, right? So this song is called Dangerous Women, and because that was Sally's essay. It's her title, so. Women won the vote in 1917 in a fight for restitution and equality. They put their bodies on the line, held hunger strikes and picket signs. Dangerous women, yes, but a bittersweet victory.
been known for more than 1,000 years. Haudenosaunee women had it better here. They were equals, held the land, chose chiefs as mother of the clan. These dangerous women gave the lie to weaves of sin. Seneca Falls, 1848. Western woman to put an end to her subjugated state. Coalitions changed as years passed by. Enfranchised white women came the cry. Came the cry, but some brave voices rejected such injustice.
Oh God.
We'll work together and do or die.
It's dangerous. It's dangerous.
Oh shit, what's the chord? Oh shit. Oh yeah.
It's dangerous to stand alone. Dangerous to say your body is your own. Dangerous to break from tyranny. Well-behaved women don't make history. How dangerous are you willing to be? But there are women whose wisdom knows no age, like Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Matilda Jocelyn Gage. They knew their liberation could only be for each and all. They learned from their native neighbors, and they heeded the call to know that none are free when one of us is not. Stanton and Gage researched their names while others retreated. They remained steadfast always to the claim that the vote alone is not enough to change, no matter what the danger. It's dangerous to stand alone. Dangerous to say your body is your own. Dangerous to break from tyranny. Well-behaved women don't make history. The vote was won, but who remains outside? Whose voice suppressed when class and race divide? We honor now their legacy when we fight for full equality. It's dangerous to stand alone, to hold your ground, unearth the stone, so power over is overthrown. Then our bodies will be our own. Be like the mothers of the clan. Take back the power to our hands. Be dangerous.
Oh, please. Why not boom stands? Be dangerous.
Be dangerous to make our history.
Sorry about the middle part. Thank you. Yeah, I'll send you the lyrics.
Okay, I just want to say one thing. Last night, the Windborn Singers, when they did a song about, you know, not necessarily seeing the fruits of your labors, but seeing the result
right.
in your lifetime. Just want to say, there's a famous quote by Elizabeth Cady Stanton that was originally in the song, but I had to edit it down. And she said to her colleagues in the movement, we're sowing winter wheat. And
yeah.
she was right, because they never got to see the fruits of their labor. They never got to vote. They passed away before they had a vote. All the women in
and
those
I,
days.
I wanted to just say one thing about the... Well, I mean, I'm going to try to write another song about this, but it's really kind of rough because there was a really big... One of the reasons why Gage was not... why she was written out of history, it wasn't like really men that did it. It was because there was a rift in the women's movement, and it was a fundamentalist Christian rift, pretty much. I mean... The same things that we're having today, and we really need to know that history, because she did not want to compromise. She knew that, you know, women of color, slavery, women's rights, they were all connected, and she didn't want to compromise that, and she didn't want to forge the coalition to, you know, just go for the vote.
We call it intersectionality.
Yes, and it went. And so this is the great tragedy. Yeah, we got the vote, but only for some people and mostly for white people. And so this is part of our historical legacy. So it's really, I mean, it's amazing. And women were put on, and they died for the vote. I mean, I don't want to, you know, that was like an incredible struggle, like Iron Jawed Angels and all those films.
Yes.
But to not have that piece of it, you know, we really need to remember, you know, that.
But just as
I'll share those essays with you too.
Just as the more recent feminist movement in the 60s kind of cut out colored women and poor women, and the suffrage movement kind of did the same thing.
Right.
To a fairly large extent. We have a couple more minutes. Are there any questions or comments? What we were hoping is,
I actually would like to know what the words are to that song where they we ne'er rebelled or something like that.
Oh, against that, yeah.
Yeah, that this line there. Yeah. I didn't totally get it.
We love our boys, our household joys. We love our girls as well. Love is from above. Against that will ne'er rebel.
Against.
There's a couple of contractions in there that we're not accustomed
to.
Against there will ne'er rebel. You wouldn't believe how many times we had to go over that to learn how to say that without tripping over our tongues.
Okay.
And a lot of the words are a little bit dated, but
it's great.
They're fun. They're fun to sing. The women's suffrage songs, a lot of them, they're just so clever and so well crafted.
In the age of poetry, it was so clever, but it was also just normal.
Yeah.
So, I mean, people just were used to having modifiers be in different places to cause the rhymes. And I get tangled up in the rhymes of the song I sang because they keep switching the don't and the won't and the chant and the cat and whatever. And the other thing, I love the way it's been pointed out that because of women needing to be liberated from men, the Temperance Union was formed as a way of just trying to get some help from the government because they had no rights. And as my ancestor's wife, Abigail Adams, you know, she was saying, "Remember the ladies."
I was wondering if you would have that.
Yeah, it's my hometown. I was born here in Boston. So it's so important not to judge the Women's Christian Temperance Union movement on that score.
Oh,
it was just another way to try to get some relief from being dominated by these.
Right.
And they had a much broader platform than just temperance, just abolition of alcohol. They had a lot of women's rights things, and they exist to this day. I found that when I Googled them. There is still a Women's Temperance, Christian Temperance Union.
There is?
Yeah. And Google them. And they have a platform, very broad, you know, women's rights, all kinds of rights for women and poor, including poor women. Hey, Ben.
So maybe they'd like me to come as a guest singer.
Yeah,
you should come and
like marketing.
Yeah.
Hey, my great grandmother here, great great grandmother.
That's incredible.
Well, this is very cool.
I was going to ask.
So let's have a hand for Colleen Cateau.
Thank you.
She was just volunteered to send us the lead sheet and all the lyrics, right? So thanks for your attention. You all are great.
So is it Jason and Melvin?
Yeah,
and
the sound guys.
And Richard South, thank you so much.
Yes,
for
great. Yeah.
And she wore purple on that.
Rebecca, our videographer.
Yes.
Thank you, Rebecca.
Thank you.
You're very color coordinated with the
work. And Colleen went over to help you get it adjusted. Thank you so much.
Okay, cool. Yeah.